Hello anatomy friends, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing the muscles of the gluteal and posterior hip region. And these muscles are composed of a more superficial or gluteal group and a deeper group of smaller muscles, and with most muscle groups we will be discussing attachments as well as innervation and, as always, actions in these regions. Starting with the superficial group, we have the gluteal muscles, or the gluteal muscles, which are organized from superficial to deep, as well as from largest to smallest, as the gluteus maximus, the gluteus medius, and then the deepest and smallest is the gluteus minimus. Let's start with the big one, the gluteus maximus, and this muscle is no joke. It is the largest, heaviest, and most coarsely fibered muscle of the body. Notice I didn't say the longest, but it is a very large muscle. I often find this muscle is difficult to reflect when we get to that part in the dissection, just because of how coarsely fibered the muscle is. It will actually cover the other gluteal muscles and, of course, the deeper layer of muscles, except for the anterior superior portion of the gluteus medius. The majority of its fibers will have a distal attachment on the iliotibial or IT tract or band. So here is the IT band right here. You can see the gluteal muscle belly right here, and you can see that it has a distal attachment there. The IT tract is a thickened lateral portion of the deep fascia of the thigh called the fascia lata that is interwoven with the flattened tendon of the gluteus maximus, as well as another muscle called the tensor fascia latae muscle, or the TFL. And we'll talk about this in another section. The gluteus maximus plays a role in lateral rotation of the hip joint, but its major action, the one I really want you to focus on, is extension of the hip joint. It is actually the strongest extensor of the hip, but it acts mostly when force is necessary. It works primarily between kind of that flexed and standing position, as when rising from a sitting position or walking uphill or upstairs. It's only used briefly during casual walking and standing motionless. That will primarily be the hamstring muscles in the posterior thigh. The gluteus maximus is innervated by the inferior gluteal nerve, which is a branch from the sacral plexus. Moving to the smaller gluteal muscles, the gluteus medius and minimus, their muscle fibers are similarly oriented, and so they're very often thought of as a group. And both are heading for the greater trochanter of the femur as a distal attachment. Because their muscle fibers are going in the same direction, they're attaching in the same place, they share similar actions, which include medial rotation of the thigh, but also importantly, abduction of the hip joint. And sometimes it's just referred to as an overall stabilization of the hip. You can see here, when a lower limb is lifted off the ground, the gluteus medius and minimus on the opposite side contract and abduct. And what happens is that allows for a stabilization or a leveling of the pelvis, so prevents the pelvis from dropping on the other side because this muscle right here is abducting. Both of these muscles are innervated by the superior gluteal nerve. Now, if there is an injury to the superior gluteal nerve, this results in a fairly characteristic motor loss, often referred to as a gluteal gait, to compensate for weakened abduction of the hip joint. So when a standing person is asked to lift one foot off the ground and stand on one foot, so this is kind of a review of what we had on the last slide, the gluteus medius and minimus normally contract on the opposite side as soon as this foot leaves the ground. So it is going to abduct to prevent tipping or dropping on this side. If there is an injury or damage to the superior gluteal nerve, if a patient is asked to stand on one leg, the pelvis on the unsupported side drops, indicating, so we have, you could see this fairly distinct dropping on this side, It's indicating that the gluteus medius and minimus on the supported side, the side with the lower limb planted on the ground, is weak and non-functioning. So it is not abducting to allow for a leveling of the pelvis. This sign is referred to as a positive Trendelenburg sign or test. And so there'll be quite a bit more discussion regarding this in the upcoming hip clinical lecture. Last but not least are the deepest muscles in the posterior hip region. These are all outlined here in red. And these are often referred to as the lateral rotators of the hip. These are smaller muscles, some of which are much, much smaller than the gluteal muscles. And most of these have a distal attachment on the greater trochanter, similar to what we had with the gluteus medius and minimus. And as you can infer from the name of this muscle group, these muscles predominantly laterally rotate the hip joint, with some playing some role in abduction of the hip. One of the largest of these muscles is the piriformis muscle, which you may remember from our discussions of the internal pelvis musculature, as it was located posterior to the levator ani muscle as well as the coccygeus muscle. And its tendon primarily will exit the pelvis via the greater sciatic notch, which you know turns into a foramen with ligaments. And this has a very close relationship with the nerve from which that foramen is named, which is the sciatic nerve. We will spend ever so much time discussing the sciatic nerve, as it is hugely important in the lower limb. But for now, I want you to remember that proximally, it has a very close relationship with the piriformis muscle. And if, say, that muscle is hypertrophied, it could cause compression on the sciatic nerve, which will have motor and sensory implications to the lower limb. That's referred to as the piriformis syndrome. All right, excellent. We have reached the summary slide, which you can use as a good study guide to the high-yield concepts regarding this learning objective. Please take time to review and reach out if you have any questions. Thanks for your time and attention.